Good morning. My name is Jane King. I use she, her pronouns. It's lovely to see you this morning. Our opening song is number 346, Come Sing a Song with Me. I think you all know it. Our opening words are by Abbe Amma Krabba. As we gather to celebrate the season of birth and rebirth, we hear the heartbeat of Mother Earth. With the springtime comes the blossoming of the plants and the emerging patterns of life. We hear the heartbeat of Mother Earth. In this time of growth and reflection, let us draw closer to nature and to each other. We hear the heartbeat of Mother Earth. In the continuing circle of life, giving thanks, we hear the heartbeat of Mother Earth.
Good morning. My name is Mike Owens. I use he and him pronouns. We're going to light our chalice now. It's all right. It's early in the morning still. All right, for those of you watching at home, please light your chalice with us. We light ours here. We kindle our chalice for springtime and renewal, for the gifts of Mother Earth and the gifts of all those who have mothered us across our lives.
Thank you.
The stones in our chalice are reminders that the land we worship on, called Ntewa Ogopoge, is the ancestral home of tribal peoples, that ongoing violence rends the hearts of people all over the world, and that climate change is real. None of these things will change unless we all commit to live in a vision of tomorrow that has reconciled colonialism, dedicated itself to peace, and found ways to live regeneratively in the natural world. May it be so.
We will have a spoken and silent meditation now. Sit quietly and upright in your seat. Close your eyes if you wish. Heart open, body and breath. Feel yourself held in this community. Allow your attention to come into the present moment. Let yourself be aware of your breath. As you breathe in and out and rest in the quiet of the present, as we rest together in the quiet, we offer you these words from Wendell Berry. We clasp the hands of those that go before us and the hands of those that come after us. We enter the little circle of each other's arms and the larger circle of lovers whose hands are joined in a dance, and the larger circle of all creatures passing in and out of life, who move also in a dance to a music so subtle and vast that no ear hears it except in fragments. These are thoughts from Kathleen McTeague. We don't hear stories about saints and sages walking the path to enlightenment, hauling bags of diapers and stacks of diaper wipes, mini sacks of tissues, liquid Tylenol and teething rings. It's hard to imagine them engaging in soul-deepening religious thought or dialogue while they wipe a runny nose or clean up after SpaghettiOs. And a parent is more likely to be found poring time and again over the words of the runaway bunny or goodnight moon than over classic sacred texts. The real journey with children is motivated not by our spiritual hungers, but by our offspring's more prosaic appetites. Although children's lovely, spontaneous ways may reawaken us to the world, being a parent often doesn't look anything like traveling a spiritual path. Parents have little time for regular prayer or meditation, Sabbath reflection, study, or journal writing. Instead, such practices may be reduced and disrupted almost to the vanishing point. The real journey for parents leads right through this life we are living, through the chaos, the interruptions, and the exhaustion. This ordinary, unsung path requires tremendous openness to the unanticipated. It meanders around 1,000 turns that feel like detours or dead ends. It requires faith that the spirit does not grow in a straight line, nor does it require traditional forms and practices, as helpful as these can be. Real spiritual growth depends on our willingness to be transformed. And very little transforms us as thoroughly as sharing our lives with children.
Hello, my friends, and happy Mother's Day. Each of us has but one wild and precious life, and that life is tended to and supported by the precious people in our lives who've chosen to devote a little bit of their wildness, a little bit of their preciousness, a little bit of their magic to nurturing us. In turn, many of us have also chosen to share some of our wild and precious time and energy in nurturing others. Both nurturing and being nurtured are spiritual experiences, friends. The one because the parental care that we receive or don't receive when we are children becomes our inner template for what a loving God or a loving cosmos looks like and feels like. And the other, because the practice of placing someone else's needs ahead of our own, of acting out love for the well-being of another person, is actually the way that we live out our Unitarian Universalist definition of love. Now, mothering, as we're thinking about today, is not gendered or confined to biological parents and their children. The kind of nurture that I think of as mothering pertains whenever we tend to the health and well-being and full expression of another person's potential when they can't tend to it themselves. There's a bit of asymmetry that happens in this mothering, parenting, mentoring, and the one being mothered, parented, mentored, because the one being mothered, parented, mentored is understood as needing care and support of the one who's doing the mothering or the parenting or the nurturing. And at times, that level of care can be pretty intense. It can be demanding. And the willingness to engage, even when it's demanding, even when it's intense, is part of what makes caring for others a spiritual path in its own right. Now, when kids are young, we take for granted that they are mothered by the caring adults in their lives. And we're also aware of the fact that as we age, that can flip, and we are perhaps in the position of mothering our parents or being mothered by our children. We hold up the caring that happens in those relationships as the exemplar of loving, just because they're so clear and so complete and in many ways so obvious. But truthfully, we receive and offer care throughout our lives, not just at the beginning or at the end. And we receive and offer care to all kinds of people in all kinds of relationships. When we're sick, or when we're grieving, when we're dying, when we are struggling with an addiction or mired in a relationship that is not going well, we really need thoughtful friends and family who will support us, wrap their arms around us, and reassure us that we're going to get through to the other side. And when those around us are in similar circumstances, we need to step forward and wrap our arms around them. I'm with you virtually this morning because I am attending the Being with Dying retreat up at the Upaya Zen Center, learning how better to companion and care for those in our community as we all get closer to end of life. Surely, this is an extension of parenting and mothering and nurturing that we are talking about this morning. So this Mother's Day, I invite you to reflect on two things. Who, in the course of your wild and precious life, has nurtured and mothered you? What did their caring mean for who you have become? And second, how have your own journeys of mother-like care transformed you and added meaning to your life? Thank you.
Many people come to this day with joy and gratitude for their mothers. We celebrate with you. However, Mother's Day doesn't call up hot hearts and flowers for everyone. In spite of widely professed and professionally packaged expressions of gratitude to mothers, I'm afraid that some of us may have reached an advanced age and still not totally forgiven our mothers for being merely human, with selfish needs and faults, people who make mistakes and have an impossible job. Are you in that uncomfortable place? If you are, I want to suggest that you contemplate your disappointment or even your trauma and let them go. They no longer serve you. Take radical acceptance as a new path. Your child self is waiting to be free, free to love yourself, love others, and love life, waiting to be free to celebrate a universe of fresh wonder every day, as children do. This rose is for my mother, Myrtle Gifford. May she have peace. And Viola Whitsett, my black nanny, my Bola. Her love and kindness banished racism and nourished self-acceptance. This morning, we have devised a way for you to send love and a flower to your mother on Mother's Day. As a former florist, I assure you, no florists were harassed or overworked for this. We invite you to come forward and place a rose into the bouquet for a mother or mothering figure in your life. You can briefly share a few words about someone who has nurtured you or something you have learned from nurturing someone else, or remain silent. Please come forward up the outside aisles. That means if you are sitting in the center section, you need to go to the back first and then come around. So that you won't be going against traffic. After the service, you're welcome to take a rose away with you. So come forward. Rise. Okay.
This rose is for my mom, Marie, and she is so loving naturally that people truly don't believe she's real.
My wonderful UU mother, Catherine Emily Nyquist Fuller. Kate.
This rose is for my mother, Jean Holliday, and all my aunts who mothered me along the line, And to me, for mothering three little boys as a single mom, and for being a grandma to my two precious grandsons.
This is for my mother, Jean Catherine O'Dwyer Brown, who was a single mother who raised two sons, and when they grew up and moved out, she went to Alaska.
This rose is from my mom, Johanna Edith Steinmetz-Fechter.
I'll hold it.
Who really lived the original meaning of Mother's Day. She was intensely involved in peace and disarmament. And this rose is also for my biological mother and for me, who also raised a child as a single mom. Thank you.
This rose is for my great-grandmother, my grandmothers, and my aunts, and also for my mother, who has did the very best that she could do as well. And then just the many friends that have come into my sphere, even in 12-step programs, that have helped that process, and to myself as well for being a mother and grandmother.
This is a rose for Kathleen McCree, my mother, who 5 years ago chose her own death, and I assisted, and I talked to her every day.
This is for my mother, Betty Gibson. She was a wonderful mother, and for my two daughters who also take care of me, and for me, who have taken care of all of them.
This rose is for my mother, Annabel Bishop, and all the mothers of Sedona who raised us kids, and all the women in my life.
This rose is for my grandmother, who was the personification of love for my mother and for motherhood in general. Thank you.
This rose is for my mother, Vita Kildebeck Salveson, who immigrated from Denmark into the Dust Bowl of Nebraska, and to my grandmothers, both of whom died before I was born, but I talk to them in the forever.
There we go.
This rose is for my mother, Esther Lippman Rosenthal, who provided me with how to be a mother and how not to be a mother. And I appreciate her coming to me in my dreams and guiding me now and protecting me.
Good morning. This is for my beautiful little mamacita, who I've missed terribly, and she's been gone for 20 years, but she's still in my heart.
This is for my mother, Geraldine Beatrix Russell Applegate, who was a great mother and did the best she could in hard environment.
This rose is for my mother, Annie Carr Bryson Heisch, and for my grandmother, Mossy Melvina.
I'll hold it.
Heisch.
I'll hold it.
And they both raised me. I lived with two mothers most of my life. My mother taught me it's okay to have ambition, and my grandmother taught me it's okay to learn to cook and sew and do other things.
This rose is for my mother, Roberta, who was a fabulous mother to all five of us.
Mom, this bud's for you.
This rose is for our mother, sitting right back there. Fantastic mother.
This rose is for my mother, Dixie Pownell, who died when I was a child, and for all the amazing ladies that stepped in and helped me and my siblings grow up and be the people we are.
Thank you. Forgive you, Mom.
This rose is for my mother and my mother-in-law and my two grandmothers, and April's rose is for me.
And this rose is for my mother, Marjorie Morgan Price, and for my maternal grandmother, Grandmother Morgan. As you can tell, I took that name. So I'm in gratitude for the modeling that they did all those years, the lives they led, just by watching what they did and feeling that love to this day. Love never dies.
Oh, I'll hold it. This rose is for my mother, Sibel Mosheim, who was alone because my father was stationed in China during World War II when I was born. So we formed a particularly close bond, and she guided me all my life by not allowing me to say, I can't.
This beautiful rose is in honor of my mother, Jeannie Marie Wettenstein Bergstrom. This is the first Mother's Day that the four of us kids have experienced without our mother. I give thanks for the many years she gave to us as kids, raising all of us four kids. And then now I also am grateful for the opportunity in the last 4 or 5 years to help her during her transition to the rest of the universe. So, yeah, thank you.
And this rose is for my mother and my grandmother, both of whom always took the time to listen.
When I heard it was Mother's Day, I tried to find a song for my mother, and I didn't have one. But this is a song that I wrote for the mother of my children. And it has some innuendo in it that doesn't apply to my mother, who was a very loving and gentle person. She corrected me when I was wrong and applauded me when I was right and never stopped shedding love on me. And even though she's not with us now, I still feel the cone of love that she put around me. And the mother of my children is very much like that.
She loves me any time of the day. She loves me now, and she always will. Well, she loves me in the kitchen. She loves me down the hall. She loves me in the bathroom. Oh, that ain't all. Lord, she loves me. Yes, she does. Loves me now, oh Lord, and she always will. Well, she loves me at the ocean, in the mountains high. She loves me by the river, even when it's dry. Lord, she loves me. You know she does. Loves me now, oh Lord, and she always will. Thank you. she took me to church and she loved me in the pew. I got up on the pulpit and she loved me there too. Yeah, she loves me. Anytime, anywhere. She loves me now, oh Lordy, and she always will.
Good morning. My name is Sue Gee. My pronouns are she and her. It is my honor and pleasure to serve on the UU Women's Fellowship Steering Committee and to share these thoughts with you today. The UU Women's Fellowship was established about 25 years ago to develop connections among UU women and to provide programs that address the interests and needs of women and girls. For many years before the pandemic, UUWF held monthly speaker luncheons that raised funds for local charities, such as Planned Parenthood, Many Mothers, Girls Inc., Casa Familia, and Esperanza Shelter. While we have not yet restarted the luncheons, UUWF has had an active year of Second Saturday speaker programs. You may have seen the posters on the UUWF bulletin board in the lobby announcing each month's program. Topics presented this past year included the Elizabeth Whitefield End of Life Options Act, Think New Mexico with 2024 Educational Legislative Initiatives, Gerard's House, serving children who are grieving the loss of a parent or caregiver, Reverend Kimmy Floyd Rush on women and the witch wound, artificial intelligence and its implications for the future, Literacy Volunteers of Santa Fe on pathways to adult literacy, the Alchemy Design Project created by Sydney Scher, focused on teaching jewelry making skills to Indonesian women who were victims of sex trafficking, microplastics in the environment, and yesterday, Ellen Bradbury Reed on her experience growing up in the secret Manhattan Project at Los Alamos. For the last program of this year, on June 1st at 10 a.m., UUWF will co-sponsor with the UU Committee on Domestic Violence to present author Deborah Taffa, who will discuss her recently published memoir, Coming of Age on and Off the Reservation, and the frictions between mainstream American culture and Native inheritance. Looking ahead, UUWF will hold our annual retreat September 27th to 29th at the Chi Center in Galisteo. The theme will be Keeping Our Balance in Troubling Times. Information and registration details will be out soon. The retreat has traditionally been a time to form new connections, share experiences, and learn new ways of being. All UU women are invited. We are always eager to receive suggestions of topics for upcoming programs, and we are actively looking for new members for the UUWF Program Committee. Please see me or Diane Brown following the service if you are interested. UU Santa Fe is supported by the voluntary generosity of all who join us. You can help support the work of UU Santa Fe with your financial offering this morning, which will now be received in grateful appreciation of your support of our shared hopes and values. Baskets will be passed here. And if you are joining us online, please go to the UU Santa Fe webpage and click the donate button. We thank you in advance for your generosity.
Some say love it is a river that drowns the tender reed. Some say love, it is a razor that leaves your soul to bleed. Some say love, it is a hunger and endless aching need. I say love, it is a flower, and you, its only seed. It's the heart afraid of breaking that never learns to dance. It's the dream afraid of waking that never takes the chance. It's the one who won't be taken, who cannot seem to give, and the soul afraid of dying that never learns to live. When the night has been too lonely and the road has been too long, and you think that love is only for the lucky and the strong, just remember that in the winter, far beneath the bitter snows, lies a seed that with the sun's love in the spring becomes the rose.
We extinguish our chalice flames, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fires of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again.
I invite you to stand now and hold hands with your neighbors if you wish for the hand-holding benediction. May love and skill be in our hands.
May love and skill be in our hands.
May love and courage fill our hearts.
May love and courage fill our hearts.
May love and wisdom light our minds.
May love and wisdom light our minds.
May love flow through us and walk among us.
May love flow through us and walk among us.
As we live our lives and work to heal our world. Amen and blessed be.
If you will sit down, we have a little bit of music before the end.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, What a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry, I watch them grow. They'll learn much more than I'll ever know. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Oh, yeah.
Thank you for joining us today, friends. We hope that you enjoyed today's service. Please take a little time and explore our website and visit our online welcome table if you'd like to know more about us. Otherwise, we'll see you next Sunday morning. Stay in touch and be well.